Hey, I wanted to make another video blog, but this time I'm just going to make it an audio, because setting up for video just kind of can be a bit of a production. And I wanted to read the foreword. I just got Plague of Corruption by Dr. Judy Mikovitz and her friend, I think Ken Heckenlively. I think his first name is Ken. And again, I'm reading from this book because they're making all the points I was literally criminalized for making since I was a child. And because I don't hear enough talk about child abuse, that's what I talk about, child abuse, the abusive family system. I'm trying to, get it out there, child abuse in the home especially, the abusive family system is what I've lived, studied, focused on, tried speaking out about all my life, and really, really, really went against the grain. I mean, you're pretty much committing suicide. And all I ever, just wanted to do was move in the direction of health. I mean, just acknowledge things so you can change course. And I mean, it was literal, like, just normal, healthy functioning is and has been a crime. It's that simple. It's that simple. And other people who live committed to health and the truth find it out just later in life than I did, than other abused. This is exactly what child abuse is, what they talk about, their experiences. So the foreword, Moral Courage in Our Common Future by Robert F. Kennedy Jr. And yet it moves. Galileo whispered those defiant words in 1615 as he left the Roman Inquisition tribunal, before which he repudiated his theory that the earth, the immovable center of the universe, according to contemporary orthodoxy, revolves around the sun. He had not recanted, his life would be forfeit. We like to think of Galileo's struggles as the quaint artifact of a dark, ignorant, and tyrannical era where individuals challenged government-anointed superstitions only at grave personal risk. Dr. Judy Mikovitz's story shows that stubborn orthodoxies anointed by pharmaceutical companies and corrupt government regulators to protect power and profits remain a dominant force in science and politics. So again, I mean, this is exactly what children feel if you have the great misfortune of being born into an unhealthy, environment. And I'm just, again, talking basic facts here. And yes, it's going to be uncomfortable, and yes, it could offend people, but if we're going to really, really move society in a healthier and fitter direction, you really have to be able to be willing to go through a lot of pain and discomfort to admit some really uncomfortable and painful truths. And the family system is one of the most dysfunctional and abusive places on earth. So Robert Kennedy Jr., Dr. Mikovitz, I mean, they're talking about corruption, dysfunction, and abuse in, high, you know, quote unquote, higher up places, but, you know, because their experience was not having all of this corruption and abuse in the family system like a lot of people did. So I'm just kind of scaling what they say down, because that was my experience, and it was a lot of people's experience. By any standard, Dr. Judy Mikovitz was among the most skilled scientists of her generation. By the way, just so you know, the foreword is about 6 pages long. And hopefully I won't make this video too long, but I have a lot to say. She entered professional science from the University of Virginia with a BA degree in chemistry on June 10th, 1980. As a protein chemist for the National Cancer Institute, working on a life-saving project to purify interferon. The quality of her work and her reliable flashes of genius soon propelled her to the apex of the male-dominated world of scientific research. So again, I just want to, you know, pause every once in a while to reiterate that this mentality of male-dominated world, it's everywhere, especially in the family system. And again, my aim for making videos like this is to talk about psych health, because it never got spoken about. Again, you know, people just lived with dysfunctional, abusive environments in the workplace and at home, like it was normal. And that's gotten us to in this society where we are today. Because if, you know, if people can't acknowledge, you know, psych health, emotional health, and what's dysfunctional, and move in a healthier direction of, you know, just relationship fitness, spiritual health and fitness, healthy relationship skills, and, you know, a thriving home and work environment. I mean, again, too many people put the paycheck first at the expense, you know, and didn't even give a thought to whether or not the work environment was, you know, abusive or dysfunctional. I mean, like, just completely put that stuff on the back burner. And you do that for enough decades, and this is the society that you leave to your children. So, I mean, you know, health is more than just physical. It's really getting down to the wire now with this COVID and vaccines and all of this, because for decades and decades, nobody put any focus on psych health, emotional health, relationship health and fitness. And this is what I put first without wavering all my life. And if more people did it, this country wouldn't be where it is today. The quality of her work and her reliable flashes of genius soon propelled her to the apex of the male-dominated world of scientific research. At the National Cancer Institute, Mikovitz began what would become a 20-year collaboration with Dr. Frank Rossetti, a pioneer in the field of human microvirology. While heading up the lab of Robert Gallo in 1977, Rossetti made scientific history by co-discovering with Bernie Poise the first human retrovirus, HTLV-1, human T-cell leukemia virus. A retrovirus is a stealth virus that, like HIV, enters the host without alerting the immune system. It may then lie dormant for years without causing harm. Before killing a person, a retrovirus will usually destroy their immune system. So again, just to pause quickly, so how are the sociopaths in power in the United States not a retrovirus? You know, that people are now waking up to that this country is infected by, but it has been for decades, and but people just make things normal. People make illness and dysfunction normal is the problem, rather than calling it what it is and taking steps early to do something about it and change course. As a result, many retroviruses cause cancer. With an escalating understanding of retrovirus behavior, the Rossetti-Mikovitz collaboration and Mikovitz award-winning PhD thesis from George Washington University in 1991 changed the paradigm of HIV/AIDS treatment, turning the disease from a death sentence into a manageable condition. From the outset, the most daunting obstacle to Mikovitz's career advancement was her scientific integrity. She always placed it ahead of personal ambition. Dr. Judy Mikovitz never meant to wade into a public health brawl. She never considered herself a renegade or revolutionary. Judy's relatives mainly worked in government or law enforcement. They believed in the bedrock American principles of hard work, respect for authority, and above all, telling the truth. That backdrop made it impossible for her to abandon her high natal standards of honesty and integrity, even when they became a hindrance. So, again, to just pause, this literally is the definition of child abuse. That when an innocent child has the great misfortune to just the act of being born into a very unhealthy environment, very unhealthy, deficient, emotionally deficient, physically deficient parents, your basic health is literally becomes criminal. Your basic healthy functioning becomes the problem because it just literally goes right up against the unhealthy surroundings. So, you know, again, if, you know, Dr. Judy Mikovitz and other people, you know, when they go to work every day, really, you know, encounter this, it's just that some people are just a lot more committed to morality and integrity than other people. Like, more people, there's a lot of people that are, you know, it doesn't matter what level of work you do. I mean, anyone can be committed to integrity and honesty. It doesn't have to be at some scientific, retrovirus level, you know, or the National Cancer Institute, you know. I mean, anybody who goes to work every day can be committed to integrity and honesty, but there's too many people who are not. From the outset, okay, apologies. So, right, the high natal standards of honesty and integrity, even when they became a hindrance. I mean, again, you know, too many people are confronted in the moment with that, you know, awful dilemma of, you know, what are you going to do? You know, choose the path of integrity and honesty or, you know, choose to go along for the paycheck. And the majority of people choose to go along for the paycheck. After leaving the NIH, the National Institute of Health, she worked a stint for Upjohn, leading a project to prove the safety of the company's blockbuster bovine growth hormone. When Mikovitz discovered the company's formula could cause precancerous changes in human cell cultures, she refused direct orders from her boss to hide her discoveries. Mikovitz's revelation suggested that the ubiquitous presence of the hormone in milk could lead to breast cancer in women who drank it. Her refusal to back down precipitated her departure from Upjohn and her return to the NIH and graduate school. Judy's war on bovine growth hormone eventually led to Upjohn abandoning the product. In 2009, now in academia, Mikovitz and Rossetti, who was still at the National Cancer Institute, led a team that discovered a strong association between a previously unknown retrovirus and myalgic encephalomyelitis, commonly known as chronic fatigue syndrome. Predictably, the retrovirus was also linked to certain blood cancers. Collaborators had named it xenotropic murine leukemia-related virus, XMRV. When they first detected it in DNA sequences in prostate cancer a few years earlier. The medical community had dealt with chronic fatigue syndrome, which strikes mostly women, in bad faith since its appearance in the mid-1980s. The medical establishment derided MECFS as a, quote, yuppie flu, and attributed it to the inherent psychological fragility of career women pursuing professions in high-pressure corporate ecosystems. Right, so just minimizing it, basically. Mikovitz found evidence for the retrovirus in approximately 67% of women afflicted with MECFS and in a little less than 4% of the healthy population. On October 8, 2009, Mikovitz and Rossetti published their explosive findings in the journal Science, describing the first ever isolation of the recently discovered retrovirus XMRV and its association to MECFS. Her revelation about MECFS immediately triggered angry reactions from jealous cancer power centers, stubbornly resistant to science that attributed cancer and neuroimmune diseases to viruses. The blowback grew even grimmer when Mikovitz's subsequent research suggested that the new retrovirus, originally found in mice, had somehow jumped into humans via contaminated vaccines. Even more troubling to the medical establishment, Dr. Mikovitz's research revealed that many of the female patients afflicted with XMRV had children with autism. Suspecting XMRV might be passed from mother to child, as with HIV, Mikovitz tested 17 of the children. 14 showed evidence of autistic regression following vaccination. Subsequent studies linked XMRV to epidemics in leukemia, prostate cancer, autoimmune disease, and the explosion of Alzheimer's disease. Worst yet, research also found widespread XMRV contamination in the blood supply and blood products. Based on her research and the findings of others, it seemed that anywhere from 3 to 8% of the population now carry the virus. XMRV had become part of the human ecology, passed from mother to child in vitro or through breast milk. Mikovitz's data suggested that more than 10 million Americans are harboring this virus like a ticking time bomb, a potential threat far greater than the HIV/AIDS epidemic. So again, I just have to keep pausing to reiterate the family system as this kind of scaled down, corrupt system. Whether by accident or people don't mean it and I don't even want to, minimize it myself. But I mean, if the family system is not a healthy place, if the family system, if parents can't raise their children right, if the home is not a truly healthy, safe, protected environment where a child can thrive to and grow to their healthy potential, I just don't understand how this has not been a glaring sign, this, what I'm constantly calling the micro of the macro, for 5 decades in my experience. I mean, how was the family system and parenting, not a glaring sign that something is wrong in this country? And the standard and quality of parenting, the people that should truly love and who are responsible first and foremost, for the health and the thriving of a human life, and yet the standard and quality of parenting and the family system just completely deteriorated over the decades, and people actually protected the abuser in power. Rather than acknowledging when something is dysfunctional and just less than a healthy and safe environment, and then at least you can move in a healthier direction, as a society. But for decades, all the people around me did was excuse the abusers in power and made the healthy truth teller and the way that the body healthfully functions wrong and criminal. So the family system and community is just literally exactly like what Judy Mikovitz and Frank Rossetti and with Robert Kennedy Jr. is writing about, just scaled down. It's exactly the same thing, scaled down, period. In January of 2011, HIV/AIDS expert Ben Berkauer published these explosive revelations in the journal Frontiers in Microbiology. He excluded Mikovitz's evidence that mouse tissue used in vaccine production was the likely vector for human contamination. Unbeknownst to Judy, her co-author on this book, Kent Heckenlively, had already independently discovered published medical research showing that the first recorded outbreak of ME/CFS was among 198 doctors and nurses at the Los Angeles County Hospital in 1934 to 1935, following their injection with an experimental polio vaccine grown in mouse brain tissue. Mikovitz's evidence threatened financial catastrophe for the world's pharmaceutical companies because of their negligent use of animal cell cultures to produce vaccines and other pharmaceutical products. Her findings put at risk billions of dollars of revenue from an entire branch of medicine called biologics, which depends on animal tissue and products. Pharmaceutical companies and their captive regulators unleashed a furious broadside against Mikovitz and Rossetti, besieging them from every stronghold. So again, I am saying that this is exactly the experience of children in, and you know, not just abusive homes, but just unhealthy, dysfunctional, less than really healthy environments where it just becomes so clear that health, a child's healthy growth and development, goes right up against the monetary system. I mean, people have to have been seeing this for decades and decades and decades that, I mean, people saw it with me when I was a child in the 70s talking about this stuff, and it just becomes, right, you know, the truth teller, the healthy person exposing and telling people about abuse and your health being harmed by abuse in the home, right, it becomes an inconvenience. It's a complete inconvenience to people, and so they end up shutting you up instead of, you know, listening and going with, you know, the health, what the body says, and listening, heaven forbid, to vulnerable people. I mean, if the family system and community and relatives are not on the side of the most vulnerable, I don't get it. This was not confusing. This was in your face corruption. Since 1971, like 1970, when I was like, you know, 6 and 7 years old, and I was literally committed to following the path of health and fitness and psych ever since, because my health was just so compromised, so diminished. In an environment of the home that should be caring and supporting and protecting your health more than any place on earth, it was the exact opposite of that. Continuing, the journal Science feverishly pressed Mikovitz to retract her October 2009 article. In September 2011, the Whitmore-Peterson Institute at the University of Nevada, Reno, fired Judy from her faculty job. Judy and her family noticed menacing-looking men following her in pickup trucks and other incidences indicating she was under surveillance. In one incident, burly thugs surrounded her home and forced her to flee in a boat. After she escaped, they barged into her home, claiming to work for the government. In November, Ventura police arrested Judy without a warrant and held her in jail for 5 days without bail. The police searched her house from top to bottom, strewing her papers everywhere. That same day, cops raided the home of her friend, Lily, and forced her to sit in a chair for several hours while they ransacked the building. National Institute of Health officials told Nevada police that Dr. Mikovitz had illegally taken her own research notebooks from their lab. This was a fabricated charge. As the principal investigator on two government grants, it was Dr. Mikovitz's obligation to retain all of her research papers. So again, I just have to keep pausing to reiterate how this is just describing the mass abusive family system. And I find it so utterly disturbing, you know, how child abuse just got so ignored. I mean, again, it's like people get taken out before they even get started. I mean, I don't know about anybody else, but I find that so disturbing. Like, I don't know how people are not so ridiculously disturbed by that. I mean, this is an experience from an accomplished, you know, somebody with high integrity, good work, ethics, experiencing this kind of treatment, being taken out because you're doing good work. That I was, saying exactly the same thing, just because you're a healthy, functioning child, you get taken out. You literally get taken out because your body functions the way it's supposed to. It's not in a lab. It's in your house. It's in your community amongst relatives and people who should, be on your side more than anything in the world. And everyone is literally in on doing the exact opposite and shaming you and your body and your health for functioning the healthy and fit way that it's supposed to, and knocking your health down a bunch of notches because, right, it's inconvenient and it exposes the fraudulent system for what it is. I mean, it just doesn't get any simpler, people. It does not get any simpler. What they're talking about in this book, throughout this book, is the exact same reason there is a mind-blowing amount of child abuse throughout the world and in the United States. Furthermore, Judy had left all the notebooks in her university office on September the 29th. That same day, someone illegally burglarized Judy's office, removed her notebooks, and then somehow planted them in a closet of her home, apparently to incriminate her. Weeks later, as Judy languished in a cell, her husband, David, found the journals neatly packed in a linen beach bag in an obscure closet in her Southern California home. David frantically took them to the jail after midnight and then handed them over to Ventura police. I mean, I just, I guess because I experienced this horror so early in life, this trauma of, your body just, literally giving every so-called adult around you when you were a child all this accurate feedback, all this, honest feedback. And because you're vulnerable, people just use the fact that you're vulnerable as a way to just try to override the way that your body is wired and just try to shut down, emotionally and physically. I mean, I literally spent my whole life studying psych. It was so obvious when I was, just so young that most of us, to some degree, are taught to be at war with our own bodies, with our bodies, just limits, with, the body says, it says. I mean, no means no. the answer is the answer. Boundaries, healthy boundaries. When the body gets harmed, it's harmed. I mean, parents are supposed to raise children. I'm constantly talking about when we learn how to walk, ride a bike, roller skate, and all this. I mean, you fall down. You get honest feedback from natural law that's telling you, you fell down. And you take that information, you integrate it, and you use it to help you become more masterful. Well, parenting should function exactly the same. And people, parents should take the honest feedback from children and use it to become more skilled and masterful and not blame the child for, you know, for being normal and fit and giving you honest feedback that makes you, like, uncomfortable and look bad, and then you just turn around and blame the child and shut them down rather than, you know, the parent and any other adult, teacher, priest, whoever. They're the ones that should be stepping up to the plate for that child. But I mean, this is what I mean. Everywhere it's become normal for, you know, thanks to corporate profit, for the child, you know, the children who are supposed to be the future. They're supposed to be like, you know, trees, you know, beautiful gardens and healthy, you know, people, adults that are supposed to thrive and be, you know, raised to self-actualize, and instead, you know, it just really, like, freaked me out for, you know, since the early 70s, how as time went by, it wasn't just the family, parents, it was everywhere, it was everyone protected the abuser in power. If they did it in the family system, they're doing it on a mass scale. And that's unhealthy, and that's dysfunctional, and that's, you know, psych and dysfunctional abusive relationships are also a part of health. You know, this is not something you need to go, you know, look under microscopes in a lab to see. It's right out in the open, and if people just knew what was healthy enough, basic healthy relationship skills, and what is and what wasn't codependent, enabling, and dysfunctional, which clearly when I was a 6 and 7 year old, no one around had any clue that they were actually being enabling and dysfunctional when they made excuses and actually helped the abuser in power to keep going further and further out of alignment. Whereas if we lived in a sane and healthy society, you know, actually giving honest critical feedback to people that are out of alignment is how you encourage them to move more towards alignment. But because, you know, this whole society is just so utterly brainwashed, you know, the work environment is just this gigantic, dysfunctional, abusive family system, as Dr. Judy Mikovitz and Dr. Frank Grussetti found out when they were a lot older than I was, and many other, you know, children who literally experience this level of retaliation, I mean, before they even reach, like a lot of times, even a year old. I mean, because the abuse that children have been sustaining over the decades has only gotten more and more sinister and depraved. And, you know, even on a physical scale, the level of health of children now, like, you know, today children have, like, adult level diseases like obesity and you know, high blood pressure, and I mean, the fitness level of children is just completely gone. So imagine what the psychological, I mean, Jeffrey Epstein again, and you know, child sex trafficking, and it's even more darker and depraved than that. While she was in jail, Judy's former boss told her husband and Dr. Russetti that if she just signed an apology admitting her paper was wrong, the police would release her from confinement and she could salvage her science career. Judy refused. No prosecutor has ever filed charges against her, but the pharmaceutical cartel and its captive scientific journals launched a campaign of vilification against her. Less than 2 years earlier, the journal Science had celebrated her. Now the same journal published her mugshot and retracted her paper. So again, if more people in life, no matter where you work, did this and just stood up for and protected what was right more than just going along for the paycheck, this country would not be where it is. Period. I mean, I did it in the home. People can do it at work. I mean, I just did it again because, I mean, this system just pushes up against you so hard. At such an early age, your body is just literally left with no choice but to just violently push back. And I got so, your body just gets so triggered so early. I just got into this habit early, you know, naively believing that's how most people lived. Clearly, I was wrong. It's way too rare, and it's unimaginably unfortunate. Judy lost federal grants for which she had the principal investigator, She had gone bankrupt trying to work and restore her good name. The scientific journals, admittedly, all now controlled by Big Pharma, have refused to publish her papers. The NIH medical libraries have locked her out. Despite spending hundreds of thousands of dollars in legal fees, she has not been able to get her day in court. The U.S. attorney in Nevada has kept the case under seal for years. Fraudulent acts of public health officials at the highest levels of Health and Human Services, HHS, have effectively rendered her unemployable. I mean, you know, again, I don't know if this really disturbs most people, but like, you know, I've been like so committed all my life to the math, to, you know, because of what I experienced so young, in not just, you know, in my own house, but, you know, neighbors, relatives. I mean, there literally was not one adult on the side of the most vulnerable. I mean, that is just a simple basic fact. No one is sticking up for, fighting for, and protecting the most vulnerable. Because if you did, you would be running into, like, this, and going right up against this completely sick, corrupt, abusive, dysfunctional system. And that is exactly what people should have been doing for the at least the last 5 decades. Especially those people who have children. The persecution of scientists and doctors who dare, see, you know, I mean, I just use children like interchangeably with scientists and doctors, you know, people that are just healthy or committed to health, who dare, I mean, challenge contemporary orthodoxies, did not take a rest after Galileo. It has always been and remains today an occupational hazard. Henrik Ibsen's 1882 play, An Enemy of the People, is a parable for the pitfall of scientific integrity. Ibsen tells the story of a doctor in southern Norway who discovers that his town's popular and lucrative public baths were actually sickening the visitors who flocked to them for rejuvenation. Discharges from local tanneries had infected the spas with lethal bacteria. When the doctor goes public with this information, local merchants, joined by government officials, their allies, in the liberal-minded independent press and other financially interested parties move to muzzle him. The medical establishment pulls his medical license. The townsfolk vilify and brand him an enemy of the people. And every single, I'm pausing here. Every single day that people do not step up to the plate and fight like hell to give their children a quality of life, you're participating in this diluting and you know, deteriorating of the health physically, psychologically, and spiritually of future generations for decades already. It's already been happening for decades. Continuing, Ibsen's fictional doctor experienced what social scientists call the Semmelweis reflex. This term describes the knee-jerk revulsion with which the press, medical, and scientific so-called, I'm adding the so-called medical and scientific community and allied financial interests, greet new scientific evidence that contradicts an established scientific paradigm. So again, to just pause, how is it possible that new, unique, fresh lives being born into the world are not going to make people take a look at, the established so-called scientific paradigm, the established financial and contradicts the financial paradigm? It's like, of course it does. I mean, there's no way that it cannot do that. Ibsen's fictional doctor experienced what social scientists call the Semmelweis reflex. This term describes the knee-jerk revulsion with which the press, so-called medical and scientific community, and allied financial interests greet new science. So how do parents then, again, and society greet new human beings being born into the world exactly the same way, with like revulsion? And instead of the new, you know, being preserved to be the new, they order, I mean, everybody experiences this. There is no way that people are going to say that they do not experience this. New people, when they join jobs, you know, new police when they join the force, new anybody when, I mean, you know, it's happened to me like so many times. And, you know, you're the new person coming in. You're the one that's, you know, should be helping wherever you enter become like healthier and fresher. And you can feel that it doesn't go that way. The new and fresh are the ones who get contaminated. Like, you're the one who gets contaminated rather than bringing fresh and clean to the stale, dirty, you know, workplace. I mean, most people at some point in their lives have experienced this, and they just make it normal and they go along with it for the paycheck, and they think because it's not on some national security level that they're not doing any harm. But you do it even at a scaled down level over enough decades, and, you know, guess what happens? And allied financial interests greet new scientific evidence that contradicts an established scientific paradigm. The reflex can be particularly fierce in cases where new scientific information, new children, suggests that established medical, and I'm adding in parenting practices, are actually harmful. I mean, how is it, again, not glaringly obvious for decades and decades and decades, parenting is harmful. Parenting is abusive. And, you know, people just made it normal. The real life plight of Ignaz Semmelweis, a Hungarian physician, inspired the term and Ibsen's play. In 1847, Dr. Semmelweis was an assistant professor at Vienna's General Hospital Maternity Clinic, where around 10% of women died from puerperal birth bed fever. Puerperal birth bed fever, based on his pet theory that cleanliness could mitigate transmission of disease-causing particles. I learned about this story when I went to get licensed in massage therapy. Semmelweis introduced the practice of mandatory hand washing for interns between performing autopsies and delivering babies. The rare fatal puerperal fever immediately dropped to around 1%. Semmelweis published his findings. I mean, again, this is exactly what I experienced all my life. And nobody's going to stand up for me, so I'm just making these videos and doing it for abused children around the world. Rather than building a statue to Semmelweis, the medical community, unwilling to admit culpability in the injury of so many patients, expelled the doctor from the medical profession. His former colleagues tricked Dr. Semmelweis into visiting a mental institution in 1865 and then committed him against his will. So, I mean, again, this is like the mass version of child abuse. People that literally get criminalized, like treated like there's something wrong with them, you know, because they're basically healthy, they're unique, you know, they're right. Do people even bother to look at the data? I mean, see, that's what I mean. It's like data, reality, math, natural law has been the enemy. I mean, people lived in denial and covering up all my life. You know, it's not just in, you know, the National Institute of Health or the National Cancer Institute. You know, I mean, why doesn't this stuff count when it's in the family system or communities? I mean, I don't get it. Like, why is one count more than the other? Semmelweis died mysteriously 2 weeks later. A decade afterward, Louis Pasteur's germ theory and Joseph Lister's work on hospital sanitation vindicated Semmelweis's ideas. Can you imagine? They killed the poor guy for being smart and right. And it's basically what happens to the majority of the people born who never get to self-actualize. The fact that the majority of the population in the United States never get to self-actualize because it would be a complete threat. Never get to reach your healthy potential. No one is even capable of raising most people to their healthy, unique potential. Because, exactly, I mean, people made it normal that you're born and you work for the criminals and help them gain more power at your own expense. I mean, the people just normalized this stuff for decades. So, you know, don't be going around now and blaming the powers that be when people made it normal for most people to not self-actualize and no one is even raising anybody to be unique and to say no. I mean, again, you could work for these institutions, but not at the expense of, you know, of yourself. And if you're going to, you know, put the paycheck above, you know, honesty and integrity, and the, you know, the workplace should be lifting and you know, praising you for your work. I mean, people have a right to be lifted up. Modern analogs abound. Herbert Needleman of the University of Pittsburgh endured the Semmelweis reflex when he revealed the brain-killing toxicity of lead in the 1980s. Needleman published a groundbreaking study in 1979 in the New England Journal of Medicine showing that children with high levels of lead in their teeth scored significantly lower than their peers on intelligence tests on auditory and speech processing and on attention measurements. Beginning in the early 1980s, the lead and oil industries, leaded gasoline was a lucrative petroleum product, mobilized public relations firms and scientific and medical consultants to lambast Needleman's research and his credibility. Industry pressured the Environmental Protection Agency, the Office of Scientific Integrity, and National Institutes of Health, and the University of Pittsburgh to launch investigations against Needleman. Ultimately, the federal government and the university vindicated Needleman. Amen to that. But the impact of the industry's scathing assault ruined Needleman's academic career and stagnated the field of lead research. The episode offered an enduring demonstration of industry power to disrupt the lives of researchers who dare to question product safety. I mean, I just want to keep intermittently going back and forth between what I'm reading and the abusive family system and child abuse, because children are the most vulnerable, and it's so easy, so unimaginably easy to program and brainwash people when they're vulnerable children and get them to go along with this system, you know, like, right, before they get to be and have the traction of a Judy Mikovitz and a Dr. Frank Rossetti. Dr. Judy Mikovitz. Continuing, Rachel Carson ran the same gauntlet in the early 1960s when she exposed the dangers of Monsanto's DDT pesticide, which the medical community then promoted as prophylactic against body lice and malaria. Government officials and medical professionals, so-called, led by the American so-called Medical Association, joined Monsanto and other chemical manufacturers attacking Carson viciously. The macro of child abuse. Trade journals and the popular media disparaged her as a hysterical woman. Industry talking points derided Carson as a spinster, the contemporary euphemism for lesbian and for being unscientific. Vicious criticisms of her book appeared in editorial pages in Time, Life, Newsweek, the Saturday Evening Post, U.S. News and World Report, and even Sports Illustrated. I'm immensely proud that my uncle, President John F. Kennedy, played a critical role in vindicating Carson. In 1962, he defied his own USDA, a captive agency in league with Monsanto, and appointed a panel of independent scientists who validated every material assertion in Carson's book, Silent Spring. See, this is what I mean. If there's no one on the side of the most vulnerable, I mean, like, again, I'm pointing out this as the macro of child abuse. And if this can happen to these smart, accomplished people, imagine what it's doing to children. It's like human beings are born and yet they don't even really exist. Because you get so brainwashed and programmed so early, your nervous system, who you authentically are, people should get to be their authentic self. This is also a part of health. And people never lived as such. I mean, people just made it normal to have a job and a paycheck. And that, like, that was being an adult. No. Human beings are supposed to self-actualize, be unique, and be completely authentic, and add to the social biodiversity. And not just, you know, be born to go work for some larger company and turning them. That's how these corporations get turned into the sociopath, corrupt, you know, killers that they are. Because there aren't enough Dr. Judy Mikovitzes and people ready to say, no, I'm not doing that. That's what a real adult does. That's what being a real adult is. And being a real adult is more important and has more value than not being a real adult, not, you know, having a spine and resisting and challenging. I'm reading this because this is how I literally was committed to living my life, because I was naive and I really believed that that's what, you know, most people would do. But I was wrong. The experience of British physician and epidemiologist Alice Stewart offers a near-perfect analogy to the medical cartel's lynching of Dr. Judy Mikovits. In the 1940s, Stewart was one of the rare women in her profession and the youngest fellow ever elected at the time to the Royal College of Physicians. She began investigating the high occurrences of childhood cancers in well-to-do families, a puzzling phenomenon given that disease often correlated with poverty and seldom with affluence. Stewart published a paper in The Lancet in 1956 offering strong evidence that the common practice of giving x-rays to pregnant women was the culprit in carcinomas that would later afflict their children. According to Margaret Hefferman, author of Willful Blindness, Stewart's findings flew in the face of conventional wisdom. The medical profession's enthusiasm for a new technology of x-rays, as well as doctors' ideas of themselves, right, which takes precedence over everything else, which was as people who helped patients. A coalition of government regulators, nuclear promoters, and the nuclear industry joined the U.S. and British medical establishments in launching a brutal attack on Stewart. Stewart, who died in 2002 at the age of 95, never again received another major research grant in England. It took 25 years after the publication of Stewart's paper for the medical establishment to finally acknowledge her findings and abandon the practice of x-raying expectant mothers. So again, I keep going back to the fact that so many people never get to self-actualize, and that would indeed be the immune system that would have prevented the sociopaths from gaining so much leverage and traction that, you know, and they would not have, you know, the Judy Mikovitzes wouldn't be so rare, and she wouldn't be taking the brunt of the abuse if more people did what she did. Dr. Judy Mikovits is heir to these martyrs and more directly to a long line of scientists whom public health officials have punished, exiled, and ruined specifically for committing heresy against reigning vaccine orthodoxies. Dr. Bernice Eddy was an award-winning virologist and one of the highest-ranking female scientists in NIH history. She and her research partner Elizabeth Stewart were the first researchers to isolate polyomavirus, the first virus proven to cause cancer. In 1954, NIH asked Eddie to direct testing of the Salk polio vaccine. She discovered while testing 18 macaques, which are monkeys, that Salk's vaccine contained residual live polio virus that was paralyzing the monkeys. How horrible. Dr. Eddie warned her NIH bosses that the vaccine was virulent, but they dismissed her concerns. The distribution of that vaccine by Cutter Labs in California caused the worst polio outbreak in history. Health officials, so-called officials, infected 200,000 people with live polio, 70,000 became sick, leaving 200 children paralyzed and 10 dead. So again, I go back to the family system. I mean, shouldn't parents be qualified people to protect, create a safe environment, and actually do a quality job in raising their own children instead of being excused when they can't, and the child is the one who's the enemy for calling it out and, you know, and needing people in power to do a good job? I mean, you know, excuse me, give me a break. I mean, people just literally made it normal. I mean, this is what is just like blows my mind. I mean, everybody was just literally in on just excusing the only person that a child has, to rely on in life. I mean, without a safe environment of a family, healthy environment of a family. I mean, if everything is so deteriorated that, you know, even the family system is, you know, just polluted and corrupt, and we're just gonna, you know, make the healthy truth teller the criminal. And that was in the early 70s, since the early 70s. You know, that doesn't sound too good to me at all. In 1961, Eddie discovered that a cancer-causing monkey virus, SV40, had contaminated 98 million Salk polio vaccines. When she injected the SV40 virus into newborn hamsters, the rodents sprouted tumors. Eddie's discovery proved an embarrassment to many scientists working on the vaccine. Instead of rewarding her for her visionary work, NIH officials banned her from polio research and assigned her to other duties. The NIH buried the alarming information and continued using the vaccines. So again, this is exactly what I lived since 1970. I was the one that people shut down. I mean, after all, I mean, if the people are not even on their own side, if the family system and neighbors and relatives are not even for their own children, I mean, you know, and protecting children and the fact that, you know, you're being harmed in your own house and they should be kind of standing up for you and listening to you when your, you know, health is being harmed and family and neighbors aren't even on the side of children, We're in a lot of trouble. I mean, I don't really want to. There's another page. There's actually another couple of pages left. I mean, it just pretty much gets to the gist of. I mean, you know, like this is the point I've been making about my own life. And how you're just literally a criminal for being healthy. Literally a criminal for wanting to live. Literally a criminal for wanting to be raised right so you can have a healthy quality of life and thrive. The mentality of everybody I was surrounded by since 1971 was, how dare I want to be, you know, healthy and thrive? How dare I, you know, not be satisfied with this completely dysfunctional, abusive, unhealthy environment? How dare I? And so how can we be surprised at you know, the where we lived today? Where this country has arrived? How? Even though Merck and Park Davis recalled, I'm sorry, I kind of skipped because, all right, maybe I won't skip, but I just don't want this video to be so long, and it already is. In the autumn of 1960, the New York Cancer Society invited Eddie to address its annual conference. Eddie chose the subject of tumors induced by the polyomavirus. However, she also described tumors induced by the SV40 vital agent in monkey kidney cells. Her NIH supervisor angrily reprimanded Eddie for mentioning the discovery publicly and banned her from public health crisis statements. Eddie argued for publication of her work on the virus, casting the contaminated vaccine supply on her urgent public health crisis. Agency bigwig stonewalled publication, allowing Merck and Park Davis to continue marketing the oncogenic vaccine to millions of American adults and children. So this, you know, again, there's a good point. It, you know, it's not even just the children that are, you know, see, it's everybody's being abused by this system. And I just can't understand for the life of me, when it was right in front of everybody when I was a kid, what this system was and how they all chose to excuse the abuser in power, and no one was on the side and listened to the, you know, the most innocent and vulnerable. I mean, it's like, this is what I mean. What I'm reading in this book was in front of everyone's face since 1970 and 1971. And they were all in on it. They chose to be in on it. Because, I don't know, there were no quality parents. Like, there's no one raising anyone. I mean, does anybody, like, see the point that I'm trying to make? I mean, you know, right, it's you know, the corporations, the money makers, like, they're like the mass abusive parents that have destroyed the family system and turned real parenting into people who just bring lives into the world and then just brainwash you to be like a victim of big pharma, and you know, and you know, parents do their own, like, Frankenstein lab experiments by just, you know, and so do neighbors and relatives, you know, just by the simple fact that they don't raise you to your healthy, unique potential so that you self-actualize and thrive. It's like, you know, as long as you can just get a job and have a paycheck, you know, that was considered being an adult. When in reality, that should actually have been considered a disability. Okay, I'm just skipping like two small paragraphs. In total, 98 million Americans received shots potentially containing the cancer-producing virus, which is now part of the human genome. So, I mean, you know, this is the reality. Man-made Frankenstein is literally making over nature and God. That's me saying that. Continuing, in 1996, government researchers identified SV40 in 23% of the blood specimens and 45% of sperm specimens collected from healthy adults. 6% of the children born between 1980 and 1995 are infected. Public health officials gave millions of people the vaccine for years after they knew it was infected. Right. Pausing. Because they don't want to lose any money. Continuing. They contaminated humanity with a monkey virus and refused to admit what they'd done. Saying that since 1971. I mean, the people do it again. There's an emotional, mental health crisis in the United States for decades. Continuing. Today, SV40 is used in research laboratories throughout the world because it is so reliably carcinogenic. Researchers use it to produce a wide variety of bone and soft tissue cancers, including mesothelioma and brain tumors in animals. So why would they want to use something that is reliably carcinogenic? These cancers have exploded in the baby boom generation, which received the Salk and Sabin polio vaccines between 1955 and 1963. Skin cancers are up by 70%, 70. Lymphoma and prostate, 66% rise. Brain cancer by 34%. Prior to 1950, mesothelioma was rare in humans. Today, doctors diagnose nearly 3,000 Americans with mesothelioma in every year. 60% of the tumors, I'm having a little bit of trouble seeing, 60% of the tumors that were tested contain SV40. Today, scientists find SV40 in a wide range of deadly tumors, including between 33% and 90% of brain tumors. 8 of 8 ependymomas, and nearly half of the bone tumors tested. In successive measures, the NIH forbade Bernis Eddy from speaking publicly or attending scholarly conferences, held up her papers, removed her from vaccine research altogether, and eventually destroyed her animals and took away access to her labs. Her treatment continues to mark an enduring scandal with the so-called scientific community, yet the NIH's Bernice Eddy playbook has become a standardized template for federal vaccine regulators in their treatment of dissident vaccine scientists who seek to tell the truth about vaccines. Dr. John Anthony Morris was a bacteriologist and virologist who worked for 35 years at the NIH and the Food and Drug Administration, FDA, beginning in 1940. Morris served as chief vaccine officer for the Bureau of Biological Standards and the National Institute of Health, and later with the FDA when the BBS transferred to that agency in the 1970s. Dr. Morris irked his superiors by arguing that the research carried out by this unit demonstrated there was no reliable proof that flu vaccines were effective in preventing influenza. In particular, he accused his supervisor of basing HHS's mass vaccination program for the swine flu, primarily on a scientific baseless fear campaign and on false claims made by pharmaceutical manufacturers. He warned that the vaccine was dangerous and could induce neurological injuries. His CDC superior warned Dr. Morris, "I would advise you not to talk about this." I mean, you know, it's like pausing. I mean, I don't want to just kind of keep repeating myself, but I'm just describing the abusive family system when I read all of this. Because, I mean, this is exactly the reason why and what makes, you know, the quality of the of too many family systems, you know, so vast, because, you know, how dare you not get, you know, to, you know, just have different ideas, you know. I mean, people are not encouraged to, like, have different ideas that challenge the system. Like, most people are just taught to go along. And the thing about, like, again, I'm just using the family system as an example. It's the one, you know, one person usually is the scapegoat, the most vulnerable one in the family system is the one that ends up expressing the disease or the ailment, the dysfunction and abuse of the system of the family. You know, the one person that everyone, like, points the finger at to, you know, to make them out to be the, you know, the sick one, the, you know, the, you know, whether they're the drug addict or, I mean, it could be, you know, right, you know, just the black sheep. But meanwhile, that one person literally is the expression, the one expression of the entire system. So if you look at the country of the United States, you know, marginalized people, homeless people, criminals, whatever, drug addicts, you know, those people are just an expression of the entire system, of the responsibility, literally, and the participation of every single person in society. And yet, you know, people want to keep pointing fingers at those people and blaming them and making them out to be, you know, the bad guy or the crazy one, or, you know, just like in this book. What, you know, and why do people do that? Because these people are reflecting back to everyone else things about themselves that they don't want to look at. You know, whether it's the family, you know, community, society, the National Cancer Institute, you know, the HHS, the FDA, whatever, you know, they're literally describing in, you know, in this book, the macro of the micro abusive and, you know, abusive dysfunctional family system that so many people are just so familiar with and yet just have lived like it's normal. I mean, people walked around all my life, you know, acting like they're not dysfunctional. People to this day say things to me like they keep perpetuating the same thinking, the same behaviors, and the same mindset that literally is what created this nightmare country that we are currently living in that needs to change. And rather than confront those things inside of themselves, which most people don't want to do, like, for instance, just the other day, I've been big into health and fitness, physically, psychologically, you know, the abusive family, child abuse, like I say every time I make a video, and, you know, big into yoga practice and emotional relationship health. And someone said to me, you know, not to, you know, don't talk, you know, exactly what they say in this book, like, don't talk about, I mean, people say that to me all the time. The very thing that we need to be doing and changing, people say to me, don't talk about it, don't talk about it. The other day, someone said, you know, about yoga practice, it's like, you know, like, some people just want to practice yoga for a workout, you know, so, like, I should just, you know, teach yoga for a workout. Like, I like to teach things for the, you know, the real nutritional value that it is, you know, that it's meant to be taught as. And, I mean, it does. It poses. I mean, I saw this in yoga and meditation. And, you know, unless you're in a position, unless you're kind of like, I mean, you know, I kind of hate to use the word privilege, but I don't know what other word, you know, to use. I mean, you have to be in a position. You have to be able to kind of afford, you know, to teach these practices, you know, the way that they're meant to be taught if you, you know, if you're going to survive. And I mean, I, you know, won't compromise, you know, the philosophy behind these practices, you know, and you know, I really, that's the whole point of these practices, is to go up against yourself and to go up against the capitalist mindset that most people are brainwashed to have, whether they're aware of it or not. We're all brainwashed to work for the system that has literally been murdering us and poisoning us for decades. And, you know, it's like, I refuse, you know, to do it. And, you know, unfortunately, you do suffer financially. And you know, and I've never worked for the National Science Institute, Cancer Institute, or, you know, Upjohn or anything like that. And yet I could easily see that everything was about money. I mean, this is decades ago, and I would have never thought that so many people would do it. And it's unfortunate that I was wrong. Today, SV40 is used in research laboratories throughout the world because, oh, I already read that part. So anyway, I'm going to just pause here because you get the gist. This level of corruption is also in families. It's all there is to it. And it's only the people who are really healthy and dedicated to not selling out. You know, everybody could not sell out if they truly wanted to, if they were truly prepared to resist. I mean, if Dr. Judy could put her career and all her money and everything on the line, then, you know, people who have a lot less than that can certainly do it. Thank you.